Good morning. It's great to see each of you here this morning. We're glad you're here to worship. Let us worship God together. Holy One, we gather this morning to worship you. You speak the truth so that our words may give grace to those who hear. May we pray in faith so that our words may give grace to those who hear. May we sing with joy so that our words may give grace to those who hear. May we listen with open minds and receptive hearts so that your words may give grace to us who hear. Amen. Let us sing together, God, whose love is reigning o'er us. Come, O God, be present with us today in your holy word. Let us speak to us as we worship as a living, piercing, judging, dividing, and uniting instrument of your glory. Give us a heart that waits upon you for guidance and direction. We pray as Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts
as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Psalm 146. Praise the Lord. Let all that I am praise the Lord. Don't put your confidence in powerful people. There is no help for you there. But joyful are those who have the God of Israel as their helper, whose hope is in the Lord their God. He gives justice to the oppressed and food to the hungry. The Lord frees the prisoners. The Lord protects the foreigners among us. He cares for the orphans and widows, but he frustrates the plans of the wicked. Praise the Lord. You may be seated. About every month, I get a letter from Kathy's aunt, Thelma. And I want to share two portions with you today. One, I love those people who turn around at the end of service and wave. It makes me feel like they're waving at me. So yes, we started it for Joyce's mother, but we are very thankful that you have kept up the tradition of waving as we finish our service. People have been asking how much we received in our August mission. We beat our goal. We doubled our goal. And we had $1,253 for our August mission. And that will all be used for God's glory. The pasta dinner is September 22nd. I have one ticket here. Do we have tickets that have not gone out to be sold yet? I left them here last week, and nobody else took them. Okay, so Dan, can you tell us where they are? Oh, Carlene knows where they're in the kitchen during coffee hour. If you would make sure that they come out, so that there were people here that weren't here 2 weeks ago, they can find them. I would also just let you know that our oldest member, Connie Stanley, she was Howard's cohort. She loved to tell the story of as teenagers riding with him. They never got it together, but she sounded like she was interested. So Connie Stanley, and within a day or two of her death, Marion Premiano, who was Connie's peer, also passed away. The family is not having a service. There was no obituary, just a death notice in the paper. So I was very glad that I was notified of that. And I did talk to Connie's daughter this week. She will be buried in Rhode Island on October 10th. When I'm in New Mexico. But the next to last Sunday in September, we just might have a small service for her after our service, as we have been doing with other people, so that we recognize as a family that part of our family is now in eternal reward. During this month of September, I will be sharing some of the 60 days of prayer from our American Baptist missionaries. And today I will do one that's already appeared in the 60 days of prayer from Jeff and Annie Dieselberg in Thailand. I met her when she was a brand new missionary back in the early 90s. So time has passed, and her prayer is, we work every day with people who are bought and sold, used and abused, and seem to be always at risk. It's not easy to remain as your salt in the world. Renew our saltiness again, O Lord, that all whom we encounter and serve may savor your presence and your purpose for their lives. Amen. And now Sharon Coe is the, well, I'm going to say new, but she's been there a few years now, Executive Director of International Ministries, and she gives us an invitation to give to the World Mission Offering. It's not moving, Kevin. Okay. Nope. We missed the video. It went right to the offering thing. He's there.
I'm holding salt in my hand to remind us that our Lord Jesus says, you are the salt of the earth. I think he was making a great missiological statement by saying, look for the good that is already there and unlock it. At International Ministries, when our bold servants like Leo Ladero or Rick and Anita Gutierrez work in health and wellness, or when Dwight and Barbara Bullock work in economic and community development, or when Jeff and Annie Dieselberg work to abolish old slavery, they are looking and contributing to, adding to, the good that God is already doing on his mission. This year, for the Lord Mission Offering, let me invite you to give of your heart in prayer and of your finances, and to join us in being the salt of the earth.
Jesus proclaimed the good news of the kingdom, curing disease, pouring out his compassion. Through Christ, the kingdom of heaven draws near. As we have received, so shall we give, freely, generously, joyfully, wholeheartedly. And now I would like to read another thing from Thelma. She wrote this just after we had sung Jesus is all the world to me, I think. But the verse words that she's referring to is, all that I needed thy hand hath provided. That song really hit home with that one sentence. When my beloved husband went to his heavenly home, her writing is getting old and a little bit harder to read, 23 years ago, two of his retirement checks stopped. I worried how I would make ends meet. The Lord has put a roof over my head and food on my table without missing a single day in 23 years. And then she adds, O ye of little faith, just remember, God will take care of you. If the ushers would come forward and receive our morning tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
gracious God, accept these gifts as signs of our desire to serve you. Make our offerings to be instruments of peace and grace in the world. Use them to heal the sick and to bring comfort to the brokenhearted, comfort for the afflicted, justice for the oppressed, and good news to all. And let all that we do be a foretaste of your reign on earth. Amen. You are my all in all.
Our scripture reading this morning is from Isaiah chapter 35, verses 4 through 7. Say to those with fearful hearts, be strong and do not fear, for your God is coming to destroy your enemies. He is coming to save you. And when he comes, he will open the eyes of the blind and unplug the ears of the deaf. The lame will leap like deer, and those who cannot speak will sing for joy. Springs will gush forth in the wilderness, and streams will water the wasteland. The parched ground will become a pool, and springs of water will satisfy the thirsty land. Marsh grass and reeds and rushes will flourish where the desert jackals once lived.
Grace and power.
We come before you today, Lord, with confession on our lips and in our hearts. We believe in an innovative God who does not wait for us to find ourselves, but comes seeking the lost and calling us each into a new way. We believe in Jesus of Nazareth as God's crucial initiative, that when he calls us to follow, Christ also gives us the power to become, both in creed and in deed, the children of the living God. We believe in the Spirit by whom Jesus still comes to us, calling us to follow him into an obedience which is true liberty, and to a humble service which is the fruit of holy friendship. We believe in the church as the fellowship of Christ's people, called to respect and support one another through joys and tribulations as we travel the roads toward the promised land of God's future. Because Christ has called each of us, in this we truly believe. We ask for healing for AJ, born last Tuesday. She's in the NIC unit, and we pray for strength for her and her parents. We lift Betty before you, Lord, for healing. It seems like it's going so slowly, but we pray for your will. We lift before you Joyce. It's been 3 weeks that she has not been able to be with us. We pray that you would bless her life with healing. We lift before you JR and Lauren, with a new baby on the way. Her name is Rayanne. A new home they just purchased. Last weekend they went to West Virginia to bring their belongings to Rhode Island. And cutting boxes, JR cut his arm. We pray, Lord, that you will knit things back together as they belong, that it won't have damaged the nerves, and that you would help them to know to the very depth of their being that you are present with them. And Lord, we also like to celebrate with those who celebrate, so we lift before you Colette and Frank Petty as they celebrate one more anniversary together. We praise you for their life and their presence in our midst. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. When the Church of Jesus.
Thank you.
Our scripture text this morning is found in James chapter 2, verses 1 through 17. My dear brothers and sisters, how can you claim to have faith in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ if you favor some people over others? For example, suppose someone comes into your meeting dressed in fancy clothes and expensive jewelry, and another comes in who is poor and dressed in dirty clothes. If you give special attention and a good seat to the rich person, but you say to the poor one, you can stand over there or else sit on the floor, well, doesn't that discrimination show that your judgments are guided by evil motives? Listen to me, brothers and sisters. Hasn't God chosen the poor in this world to be rich in faith? Aren't they the ones who will inherit the kingdom he promised to those who love him? But you dishonor the poor. Isn't it the rich who oppress you and drag you into court? Aren't they the ones who slander Jesus Christ, whose noble name you bear? Yes, indeed. It is good when you obey the royal law as found in the scriptures. Love your neighbor as yourself. But if you favor some people over others, you are committing a sin. You are guilty of breaking the law. For the person who keeps all of the laws except one is as guilty as a person who has broken all of God's laws. For the same God who said, you must not commit adultery, also said, you must not murder. So if you murder someone but do not commit adultery, you have still broken the law. So whatever you say or whatever you do, remember that you will be judged by the law that sets you free. There will be no mercy for those who have not shown mercy to others. But if you have been merciful, God will be merciful when he judges you. What good is it, dear brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but don't show it by your actions? Can that kind of faith save anyone? Suppose you see a brother or sister who has no food or clothing, and you say goodbye and have a good day, stay warm and eat well, but you haven't given that person any food or clothing. What good does that do? So you see, faith by itself isn't enough. Unless it produces good deeds, it is dead and useless. Because of medical life support procedures, the cessation of heartbeat and breathing is sometimes not sufficient to say definitively that death has occurred. So when is someone dead? We begin with this discussion and then move to the book of James, where the apostle defines what constitutes dead faith. Doctors sometimes must tell people in a waiting room that their loved one is dead. It's a pronouncement none of us ever wants to hear regarding a loved one, but when a person is declared dead, it's important that the declaration be correct. Rarely, but occasionally, a person who appears to have died is not dead after all. He or she suddenly exhibits signs of life again, and some even fully recover. So doctors want to get it right. Because of medical life support procedures, the cessation of heartbeat and breathing is sometimes not enough to say definitively that death has occurred. A stopped heart can sometimes be restarted, and we know those of our family who that's happened to. In fact, stopping and starting a patient's heart is standard procedure during heart surgery, and breathing can be sustained by a ventilator. Therefore, in cases when a person is sustained by life support but is believed to be otherwise dead, there's a standard that has been adopted by every state in our country. The patient is dead when there is no longer any functioning brain activity. This is determined in two ways. First, by a detailed process that ascertains the person's inability to respond to voice, touch, pain, or other stimuli, and second, by confirming that the brain stem is no longer works to regulate the person's breathing. Thus, if removed from a ventilator, the person will not breathe on his or her own. Dr. Corey Franklin, who was director of medical intensive care at Cook County Hospital in Chicago for more than 20 years, says, "No patient with a proper diagnosis of brain death has ever recovered to come off life support. Even with life support, no one has survived for a prolonged period, and when life support is withdrawn, the heart invariably stops within minutes." So we know when a person is dead. When is our faith dead? While physical death is not our subject, we've begun with a matter of setting criteria for when death occurs, because in a sense, that's what the biblical writer James is doing in our passage for today. He's not talking about dead people, he's talking about dead faith. He gives a shorthand version of his criteria in verse 17. So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. But in the preceding verses, he spells it out more clearly. James' criteria for dead faith includes acts of favoritism and partiality that result in dishonoring the poor within a Christian context, failure to keep the whole law, but instead choosing this piece and this piece and this piece. This practice does not honor the divine law behind them all. Love your neighbor as yourself. Showing no mercy, paying lip service to one's faith and not expressing that faith through good works. All of that can be summed up in his declaration that faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. These criteria for declaring faith dead aren't given to help us make judgments about other people's faith. Rather, they are only for self-diagnosis. With the help of the Holy Spirit, James' signs of dead faith can enable us to resuscitate our faith when it is no longer moving. No longer moving is exactly the right phrase, because unlike when a person physically dies and no longer communicates and no longer moves, people with dead faith keep right on talking even when they're stopped moving, as it were. The late Ethel Barrett, who was known for her skill in telling Bible stories to children, put it this way: "You have a tongue in your head and two tongues in your shoes. No matter what the tongue in your head is saying, the tongues in your shoes tell what you're doing and where you're going. And the awful truth that is that the tongue in your shoes have the last word." Are you moving in the right direction? And it was psychologist Alfred Adler who said, "Trust only movement. Life happens at the level of events, not of words. Trust movement." Thus it follows that what we do tells more about the state of our faith than what we say. And that is indeed is what James meant when he said, "So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead." Or as someone popularly put it, we need to not only talk the talk, but to walk the walk as well. Some go off on a target at this point to argue that what James says about good works seems to contradict what Paul said. In Romans, Paul declared, "For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from works prescribed by the law." And in Galatians, he said it again, "And we have come to believe in Christ Jesus so that we might be justified by faith in Christ and not by doing the works of the law, because no one will be justified by the works of the law." But Paul was talking about when we were still in the darkness of sin, where faith plus nothing else but the grace of God brings us to a new life. James is talking about after we're in the new life, letting it die by not walking the talk. Coming to faith and then not expressing that faith in works makes as much sense as whamming a ball over the back fence for a homer and then just standing there on home plate. Besides, Paul is as clear as James that works matter in the Christian life. Paul writes in Ephesians, "For we are what God has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life." The faith works dichotomy in the New Testament does remind us, of course, that being a disciple of Jesus is not all about good works. There are important matters of repentance and belief involved, but faith and work do belong together. We might think of a rowboat with the word faith in one oar and the word works on the other. When we try rowing with either of these oars alone, we go around in circles. Clockwise with one, counterclockwise with the other. To actually go anywhere, both oars need to be used together. If your faith is dead, you're not much more than a Christian wannabe, a pretender and a fake. Think about how to spot a counterfeit bill. Some have argued that Treasury agents in the United States and the FBI agents who specialize in dealing with the problem of counterfeit money and bonds don't spend much time studying the counterfeit itself. What they spend their time studying is the real thing. They study the real $1 bills and the fives and the tens, and just as important are the 20s, the 50s, and the hundreds. They get so good at recognizing those bills that they can just pick up a fake and immediately and automatically know it's fake because it doesn't match, feel, or look like the real thing. Even ordinary citizens, however, can spot phony bills. Since 2009, when the new $100 bill was introduced, many new features make it harder for criminals to counterfeit money. Those features include that color-shifting ink, hidden threads, holograms, and more. So what are the secret marks of a true Christian that help us to identify? First is a working faith. In case any of his readers don't know what James means by works, he gives an example. If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, "Go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill," and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? That's lip service, not works. For an example from our own time, consider a cartoon we saw. It showed a woman lying on a couch, obviously sick and miserably so. The sink stacked high with dirty dishes, a huge basket of clothes to be washed sat nearby, two dirty children were fighting in a corner, and in the other, a cat was licking milk from a puddle where a carton had split open. A smiling woman stood in the doorway saying, "Well, Florence, if there's anything I can do to help, don't hesitate to let me know." The Let's not think of works only as addressing obvious needs that present themselves to us. James does not offer his criteria of dead faith as a general and theoretical document. Rather, he's responding to a specific scenario. He says in verse 2 that he's addressing what he has seen happen when a wealthy person comes into the assembly. That is, into his reader's specific church community. He notes that the rich person may be offered a seat of honor, while a poor person is shunted to the side. In so doing, James says, the church members involved are dishonoring the poor. It's an attitude of favoritism. The good work, in this case, is to respond to even everyday situations in a way that reflect the values of Jesus. The resurrection of faith is another. This is a good time to remind ourselves that a cornerstone of the Christian faith is resurrection. Even dead faith can come alive again. Indeed, that was likely James' aim in issuing his criteria for knowing when faith was dead, so that believers would get moving and become doers as well. Now, I might say that doing is not just putting on dinners or craft fairs. Those are good, but there's personal doing, moving, that is needed. There's an old fable about a man walking through the forest who saw a fox that had lost its legs. The man wondered how the fox lived. Then he saw a tiger come with game in its mouth. The tiger ate its fill and left the rest for the fox. The man saw the hand of God in this, and he decided he would learn a lesson from it. He would rest in a corner with full trust that the Lord would provide him with all that he needed, just as he had done for the fox. So he did this for many days, but no one brought him anything. When he was almost at death's door, he heard a voice say, "Oh, you who are in the path of error, open your eyes to the truth. Follow the example of the tiger and stop imitating the disabled fox." Yes, some are disabled and can't do for themselves. But those who can do them for themselves should do for themselves and to help those who can't. As Paul said, in agreement with James, we are what God has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. Let us pray. O Lord our God, we recognize none of us are perfect. None of us keep all of the law. You are our God. You will and want to give us the strength to move in actions that would be pleasing in your sight. May we depend upon your Spirit to guide us while we continually pray that your will be done, and that you would work through us. In Christ's name, amen. Here I am, Lord.
Thank you.
pursue love, strive for the things of the Spirit.
Do good work.
Be well in the name of God,
our Creator,
Christ,
our Savior,
and the Spirit,
our mighty defender.
Amen.